We deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us.
But if we confess our sins, God is faithful and just, will forgive us our sins, and cleanse us of all unrighteousness.
Oh.
whatever is contrary to their confession, and follow all such things as are pleasing to you. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Almighty God, you have enriched your church with the proclamation of the gospel through the evangelist Saint Mark. Grant that we may firmly believe these glad tidings and daily walk according to your word. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
The Old Testament reading for the fourth Sunday of Easter is from Isaiah chapter 40. To whom then will you compare me, that I should be like him? Thus says the Holy One. Lift up your eyes on high and see. Who created these? He who brings out their host by number, calling them all by name, by the greatness of his might, and because he is strong in power, not one is missing. Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God? Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint, and to him who has no might, he increases strength. Even youths shall faint and be weary, and young men shall fall exhausted. But they who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall not run, they shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The epistle is from 1 Peter, chapter 2. Beloved, I urge you as sojourners and exiles to abstain from the passions of the flesh, which wage war against your soul. Keep your conduct among the Gentiles honorable, so that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day of visitation. Be subject for the Lord's sake to every human institution, whether it be to the emperor as supreme, or to governors as sent by him to punish those who do evil and to praise those who do good. For this is the will of God, that by doing good you should put to silence the ignorance of foolish people. Live as people who are free, not using your freedom as a cover-up for evil, but living as servants of God. Honor everyone, love the brotherhood, fear God, honor the emperor. Servants, be subject to your masters with all respect, not only to the good and gentle, but also to the unjust. For this is a gracious thing, when, mindful of God, one endures sorrows while suffering unjustly. For what credit is it if, when you sin and are beaten for it, you endure? But if, when you do good and suffer for it, you endure, this is a gracious thing in the sight of God. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
to us. A little while, and you will not see me, and again a little while, and you will see me. And because I'm going to the Father. So they were saying, what does he mean by a little while? We do not know what he is talking about. Jesus knew they wanted to ask him, so he said to them, is this what you are asking yourselves? What I meant by saying, a little while and you will not see me, and again a little while and you will see me? Truly, truly, I say to you, you will weep and lament, but the world will rejoice. You will be sorrowful, but your sorrow will turn into joy. When a woman is giving birth, she has sorrow because her hour has come. But when she has delivered the baby, she no longer remembers the anguish, for joy that a human being has been born into the world. So also you have sorrow now, but I will see you again, and your hearts will rejoice, and no one will take your joy from you. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord
to you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. The word of God upon which we would like to meditate on this fourth Sunday of Easter called Jubilate is the Holy Gospel, in which Jesus speaks of this jubilation. Your heart will rejoice, and your joy no one will take from you. Alleluia, alleluia. Christus vincit, Christus regnat, Christus imperat. Jubilate celi, jubilate mundi, Christus Jesus surrexit vere. Christ conquers, Christ reigns, Christ rules. Rejoice, O heaven, rejoice, O earth. Christ Jesus is risen indeed. Alleluia. Dear friends in Christ, the Fountain of Youth is a legendary spring that supposedly restores the youth of anyone who drinks of its waters. Tales of such a fountain have been recounted across the world for thousands of years, appearing already in the writings of Herodotus, an ancient Greek historian of the 5th century BC. The legend became particularly prominent again in the 16th century through the exploits of the Spanish conquistador Juan Ponce de León, who made a name for himself as an explorer of the New World around the time of the Reformation in Europe. According to the story, Ponce de León was searching for the Fountain of Youth when he traveled to what is now Florida in about the year 1513. He never found it, so please don't move to Florida. You might wonder, though, how such legends get started. Since the fall of Adam, when our first parents were expelled from the Garden of Eden, mankind has longed for a return to the blessed state of perfection and communion with God, which they enjoyed in the heavenly paradise. Stories like the Fountain of Youth simply spring forth from this yearning of the collective consciousness or natural law within us of mankind for a return to that state of blessedness where death is a foreign idea and life is the only reality. It is the desperate yearning for heaven on earth and the belief that somehow it is within our reach. If only we could find the Fountain of Youth. If only we could find the old age gene and figure out how to modify it for eternal youth. If only we could set up the right kind of society or government. If only, if only, if only. But the more man has tried, the more he has failed or even made a wreck of things. From the Tower of Babel's reach to the sky, to the vain attempts of Marxism and communism. In today's gospel, Jesus speaks to this very matter and sets forth the true Fountain of Youth, the real heaven on earth. We will break this gospel down into three parts. Entendre, a French word that means understanding or meaning. Double entendre, and triple entendre. Speaking to his disciples before his passion, Jesus says, "A little while and you will see me no longer." First of all, we might well understand that Jesus means his passion and death on the cross, when the presence of the Lord would be taken away. But that the disciples might not lose heart, he quickly adds, "And again, a little while and you will see me." Again, you well conclude that here he means his resurrection on the third day. But then Jesus adds another word which might seem a bit strange even to us who live long after the first little while. When Jesus lay in the grave, and the second little while, when he rose again on the third day, he says, "And again a little while, and you will see me. That is because I'm going to the Father." The disciples were surely confused as they scratched their heads. What is this that he is saying? Because I'm going to the Father. If he is returning to his heavenly Father, how is it that we will see him again? We live in the afterglow of the resurrection. We know what the apostles preached after Pentecost, the wonderful works of God, as the Spirit gave them utterance. And Luke says again in Acts, Jesus also presented himself alive after his suffering by many infallible proofs, being seen by them during 40 days and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God. Now, when he had spoken these things, while they watched, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. He was received up into heaven and sat down at the right hand of God. And they went out and preached everywhere, the Lord himself working with them and confirming the word through the accompanying signs. Double entendre. From this you might get the idea that Jesus had something more in mind by the words, a little while and you will not see me, and again a little while and you will see me, that is because I am going to the Father. Because Jesus really did ascend into heaven and go to the Father, you might now understand a deeper meaning. I suppose the first little while of not seeing him could refer to the time between his ascension into heaven, and the second little while of seeing him again refers to his visible return on the last day. But that has proven to be not such a little while, has it? St. Peter gets at this in his second epistle, the purpose of this letter, he says to the church, was to stir up your minds, that you may be mindful of the words which were spoken, knowing this first, that scoffers will come in the last days, walking according to their own lusts, and saying, "Where is the promise of his coming? For since the fathers fell asleep, all things continue as they were from the beginning of creation." Jesus himself says in our gospel, "Truly, truly, I say to you, you will weep and lament, but the world will rejoice, and you will be sorrowful, but your sorrow will be turned into joy." But Peter reminds us, "Beloved, do not forget this one thing, that with the Lord one day is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years as one day." The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some count slackness, but is long-suffering toward you, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Christians, during their little while in this world, do experience the ridicule of the world, along with the taunts and temptations of the devil and the old Adam, who so easily succumbs to temptation and just as easily joins the world in its ridicule and resistance of the word of Christ. With this, there comes a certain kind of sadness. As Jesus says, you will be sorrowful. There is a yearning in the heart of the Christian for that second little while, when the Lord returns to take us to himself forever. As the hymn goes, "With high delight let us unite in songs of jubilation. Ye pure in heart, all bear your part, sing Jesus Christ, our salvation. To set us free forever, he is risen and sends to all earth's ends good news to every nation. But it is right here, in the midst of such yearning, that the Christian is tempted to go searching for that fountain of youth. We feel alone in the world with Christ seated at the right hand of the Father. Worlds away from us in heaven. We do not see Jesus as the disciples did during those blessed 40 years after his or 40 days after his resurrection. Instead, we feel that we are living in that little while of which Jesus says, "You will not see me." We feel the vibrant life of youth slipping away and the mortality of age drawing ever closer. And so we start looking around to our own fountain of youth, but in all the wrong places. It might not be Florida, as it was for Ponce de Leon, but the vain attempt is the same. St. Peter says, "Beloved, I urge you as sojourners and exiles to abstain from the passions of the flesh, which wage war against your soul." The passions of the flesh are simply the desires of our old nature, the old Adam in us, desires that search for happiness and the good life, fountain of youth, in every place except where Christ would have us find him. And Christ would have us find him. As St. John says in today's epistle, "See what kind of love the Father has given to us, that we should be called children of God. And so we are. Beloved, we are God's children now. And what we will be has not yet appeared. But we know that when he appears, we shall be like him." Okay. We know that we will be like him when he comes again on the last day. But what about now? We are God's children now, it says. Where do we find this? Where would Christ have us find him now? Triple entendre. This leads us to yet a third sense that Jesus has in mind with his words, "a little while." The life of the Christian is a little while lived by faith. It is not unlike the children of Israel as they wandered 40 years through the wilderness, fraught with danger and temptation. Sorrow often filled their hearts too, and in the throes of anguish they often did not fare very well. How often they lost heart and complained against the Lord. How often their trust in God failed and lapsed into unbelief. How often they went searching for their own fountain of youth, yearning for the meat pots and bread of Egypt, desiring to return to their slavery under Pharaoh, where at least they would have a mouthful without faith. Or how about when Moses delayed coming down from Mount Sinai, how quickly they turned from the Lord and made for themselves the golden calf, an idol fashioned after the false religions around them. But in spite of their unfaithfulness to God, the Lord remained faithful to them. Each little while away from the Lord, each little while of temptation to sin or despair, was followed by yet another little while of seeing the Lord again, a little while of forgiveness and restoration to faith in the true God of Israel. It was a pattern, a little while of blinding desert heat wilderness and trial, followed by a desert oasis where their eyes were soothed and their thirst quenched by refreshing water. Their bodies nourished by manna from heaven, and their faith in the Lord again restored. This is the pattern with us too. For a little while we are thrust into the wilderness of our world, also fraught with temptations, lapses into sin, and despair of God's mercy. But God has also dotted the map of our lives with a succession of desert oases. Jesus says, "And again a little while, and you will see me." That is, because I am going to the Father. He's going to the Father, to be sure, but he's not going away from you to be with the Father and not with you. For he has promised, "Behold, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." Rather, he goes to the Father in order to draw him to us and us to him. As St. Paul says, God was in Christ, reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and committing to us the word of reconciliation. Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ, God making his appeal through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. For he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. This is our desert oasis, right here at First Lutheran. The baptismal font is the true fountain of youth. The word of the reconciliation, the gospel, the good news of sins forgiven, is the very voice of the crucified and risen Lord Jesus in your midst. You kneel at the communion rail before Jesus himself, who appears to you in person with his very body and blood, given and poured out for you to eat and to drink for the forgiveness of sins. Through his body and blood, the faithful have heaven on earth. For if Christ, who is seated at the right hand of the Father, is present in the sacrament, then the Lord's Supper is truly your heaven on earth. Because Christ is present there, the altar of the church stands at the intersection between heaven and earth, time and eternity. The right hand of God extends this far, even to your little haven during your little while here in Boston. So that when you come here, beaten down by the sorrows and failings of life, Jesus says, "I will see you again." And your hearts will rejoice, and no one will take your joy from you. For Christ conquers, Christ reigns, Christ rules. Rejoice, O heaven! Rejoice, O earth! Christ Jesus is risen indeed. Amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever.
Amen.
Arise and receive the blessing. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. We confess our holy faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God,
the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in the Lord Jesus Christ, the only God, Son of God, begotten of the Father before all
Let us pray for the whole Church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. How awesome are your works, O Lord, chiefly the resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ. Show the light of your honor and great power in those in error's darkness, that by the Holy Spirit's work they would submit themselves to Christ's gracious redemption. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Preserve your church, O Lord, from every sorrow and mockery of the enemy. In this little while between Christ's resurrection and our own, do not let the threats of persecution, loss, or discomfort turn us from the joy and confidence of his redemption. Sustain all preachers faithful to their calling, all confessors steadfast in their trials, and all Christians firm in the faith for life. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers for all Christian homes. Preserve all married couples and those soon to be married in love and faithfulness, especially Leah and Trent. Strengthen all parents for their tasks as teachers of the faith. Uphold the unmarried, honorable, and unashamed in their station, and with good deeds in every home. Let the ignorance of foolish people be put to silence by your divine institution. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Almighty God, it is your will that every human institution exercise the authority you give them from above to punish those who do evil and praise those who do good. Give us good government at every level, under which we may honor everyone, love the brotherhood, and fear God. Above all, let our subjection be offered always for your sake as sojourners and exiles in this world. And if we must endure suffering, let it be unjustly and mindful of you. Lord, in your mercy. Father, on the day when this little while ends, we will ask nothing. Now, in every need, we are bold to ask everything in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our mediator. Hear our supplications and intercessions for every need, especially for the health of Ingo, Beth, Ron, Rita, Norma, Vitina, Marilyn, and Michael, Lorraine, Peter, Mary, Betty, Lee, Pauline, Diane, and Karen, and for our homebound, Anna, Bob, and Bayeen, and for the Krikova family whose father was called home to his Savior yesterday. Comfort them by the certain hope of the resurrection of the body and the life everlasting. Lord, in your mercy, give joy in the midst of sorrow here at the sacrament of the altar. Give repentance, a firm faith, and a united confession that we may have honest fellowship in the blessings of Christ's testament. With consciences thus cleansed from evil and renewed in you, enable us to stand undaunted until the day of visitation. Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, of your fatherly goodness, you allow your children to come under your chastening rod to conform us to your only begotten Son, here in suffering on earth and hereafter in glory. Comfort us by your Holy Spirit in all temptations and afflictions, that we would not despair, but trust continually in your Son's promise that our trials will endure but a little while, and then be followed by eternal joy. Grant that we would overcome all evil in patient hope and at last obtain eternal salvation. Through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
and will call on the name of the Lord. Will pay my vow to the Lord now, in the presence of all his people, in the courts of the Lord's house, in the midst of you, O Jerusalem.
The Lord be with you.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, Everlasting God. And most especially, we are bound to praise you on this day for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, the very Paschal Lamb who was sacrificed for us and bore the sins of the world. By his dying, he has destroyed death, and by his rising again, he has restored to us everlasting life. Therefore, with Mary Magdalene, Peter, and John, and with all the witnesses of the resurrection, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying,
Blessed are you, Lord of heaven and earth, for you have had mercy on those whom you created and sent your only begotten Son into our flesh to bear our sin and be our Savior. With repentant joy we receive the salvation accomplished for us by the all-availing sacrifice of his body and his blood on the cross. Gathered in the name and the remembrance of Jesus, we beg you, O Lord, to forgive, renew, and strengthen us with your word and spirit. Grant us faithfully to eat his body and drink his blood as he bids us to do in his own testament. Gather us together, we pray, from the ends of the earth to celebrate with all the faithful the marriage feast of the Lamb in his kingdom, which has no end. Graciously receive our prayers, deliver and preserve us. To you alone, O Father, be all glory, honor, and worship, with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night in which he was betrayed,
took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me."